Narn I Hin Húrin, The Tale of the Children of Húrin, by J.R.R. Tolkien. Edited by Christopher Tolkien and read by Christopher Lee. Chapter 1. The Childhood of TÚRIN. Hador Goldenhead was a lord of the Edain and well-beloved by the Eldar. He dwelt, while his days lasted, under the lordship of Fingolfin, who gave to him wide lands in that region of Hithlum which was called Dor Lomin. His daughter, Glorethel, wedded Haldir, son of Halmir, lord of the men of Brethil. And at the same feast, his son, Galdor the Tall, wedded Hareth, the daughter of Halmir. Galdor and Hareth had two sons, Húrin and Húor. Húrin was by 3 years the elder, but he was shorter in stature than other men of his kin. In this, he took after his mother's people, but in all else, he was like Hador, his grandfather, strong in body and fiery of mood. But the fire in him burned steadily, and he had great endurance of will. Of all men of the north, he knew most of the counsels of the Noldor. Húor, his brother, was tall, the tallest of all the Edain, save his own son Tuor only, and a swift runner. But if the race were long and hard, Húrin would be the first home, for he ran as strongly at the end of the course as at the beginning. There was great love between the brothers, and they were seldom apart in their youth. Húrin wedded Morwen, the daughter of Baragund, son of Bregolas of the house of Beor, and she was thus of close kin to Beren One Hand. Morwen was dark-haired and tall, and for the light of her glance and the beauty of her face, men called her Elethwin, the Elven Fair. But she was somewhat stern of mood and proud. The sorrows of the House of Beor saddened her heart, for she came as an exile to Dor Lomin from Dorthonion after the ruin of the Bragolach. TÚRIN was the name of the eldest child of Húrin and Morwen, and he was born in that year in which Beren came to Doriath and found Lúthien Tinúviel, Thingol's daughter. Morwen bore a daughter also to Húrin, and she was named Úrwen, but she was called Lalaith, which is laughter, by all that knew her in her short life. Húor wedded Rian, the cousin of Morwen. She was the daughter of Belegund, son of Bregolas. By hard fate was she born into such days, for she was gentle of heart and loved neither hunting nor war. Her love was given to trees and to the flowers of the wild, and she was a singer and a maker of songs. 2 months only had she been wedded to Húor, when he went with his brother to the Nirnaeth Arnoediad, and she never saw him again. But now the tale returns to Húrin and Húor in the days of their youth. It is said that for a while the sons of Galdor dwelt in Brethil as foster sons of Haldir their uncle, after the custom of northern men in those days. They often went to battle with the men of Brethil against the Orcs, who now harried the northern borders of their land, for Húrin, though only 17 years of age, was strong, and Húor the younger was already as tall as most full-grown men of that people. On a time, Húrin and Húor went with a company of scouts, but they were ambushed by the Orcs and scattered, and the brothers were pursued to the ford of Brithiach. There they would have been taken or slain, but for the power of Ulmo that was still strong in the waters of Sirion. And it is said that a mist arose from the river and hid them from their enemies, and they escaped over the Brythiach into Dimbar. There they wandered in great hardship, among the hills beneath the sheer walls of the Chrysaigrim, until they were bewildered in the deceits of that land, and knew not the way to go on or to return. There Thorondor espied them, and he sent two of his eagles to their aid. And the eagles bore them up and brought them beyond the encircling mountains to the secret vale of Tumladen and the hidden city of Gondolin, which no man had yet seen. There Turgon the king received them well when he learned of their kin, for Hador was an elf friend, and Ulmo, moreover, had counselled Turgon to deal kindly with the sons of that house, from whom help should come to him at need. Húrin and Húor dwelt as guests in the king's house for well nigh a year, and it is said that in this time Húrin, whose mind was swift and eager, gained much lore of the elves, and learned also something of the counsels and purposes of the king. For Turgon took great liking for the sons of Galdor, and spoke much with them. And he wished indeed to keep them in Gondolin out of love, and not only for his lore, that no stranger, be he elf or man, who found the way to the secret kingdom, or looked upon the city, should ever depart again, until the king should open the leaguer, and the hidden people should come forth. But Húrin and Húor desired to return to their own people, and share in the wars and griefs that now beset them. And Húrin said to Turgon, "Lord, we are but mortal men, and unlike the Eldar. They may endure for long years, awaiting battle with their enemies in some far distant day. But for us, the time is short, and our hope and strength soon wither. Moreover, we did not find the road to Gondolin, and indeed we do not know surely where this city stands, for we were brought in fear and wonder by the highways of the air, and in mercy our eyes were veiled." Then Turgon granted his prayer, and he said, "By the way that you came, you have leave to return, if Thorondor is willing. I grieve at this parting, yet in a little while, as the Eldar accounted, we may meet again." But Maeglin, the king's sister son, who was mighty in Gondolin, grieved not at all at their going, though he begrudged them the favour of the king, for he had no love for any of the kindred of men. And he said to Húrin, "The king's grace is greater than you know, and some might wonder wherefore the strict law is abated for two knave children of men. It would be safer if they had no choice but to abide here as our servants to their life's end." "The king's grace is great indeed," answered Húrin, "but if our word is not enough, then we will swear oaths to you." And the brothers swore never to reveal the counsels of Turgon, and to keep secret all that they had seen in his realm. Then they took their leave, and the eagles coming bore them away by night, and set them down in Dor Lomin before the dawn. Their kinsfolk rejoiced to see them, for messengers from Brethil had reported that they were lost. But they would not tell even to their father where they had been, save that they were rescued in the wilderness by the eagles that brought them home. But Galdor said, "Did you then dwell a year in the wild? Or did the eagles house you in their eyries? But you found food and fine raiment, and return as young princes, not as waifs of the wood." "Be content, father," said Húrin, "that we have returned, for only under an oath of silence was this permitted. That oath is still on us. Then Galdor questioned them no more, but he and many others guessed at the truth. For both the oath of silence and the eagles pointed to Turgon, men thought. So the days passed, and the shadow of the fear of Morgoth lengthened. But in the 469th year after the return of the Noldor to Middle-earth, there was a stirring of hope among elves and men. For the rumour ran among them of the deeds of Beren and Lúthien, and the putting to shame of Morgoth, even upon his throne in Angband. And some said that Beren and Lúthien yet lived, or had returned from the dead. In that year also, the great councils of Maedhros were almost complete, and with the reviving strength of the Eldar and the Edain, the advance of Morgoth was stayed, and the Orcs were driven back from Beleriand. Then some began to speak of victories to come, and of redressing the Battle of the Bragolach, when Maedhros should lead forth the united hosts and drive Morgoth underground and seal the doors of Angband. But the wiser were uneasy still, fearing that Maedhros revealed his growing strength too soon, and that Morgoth would be given time enough to take counsel against him. Ever will some new evil be hatched in Angband, beyond the guess of elves and men, they said. And in the autumn of that year, to point their words, there came an ill wind from the north under leaden skies. The evil breath it was called, for it was pestilent, and many sickened and died in the fall of the year in the northern lands that bordered on the Angfauglith. They were, for the most part, the children of the rising youth in the houses of men. In that year, Túrin, son of Húrin, was yet only 5 years old, and Úrwen, his sister, was 3, in the beginning of spring. Her hair was like the yellow lilies in the grass as she ran in the fields, and her laughter was like the sound of the merry stream that came singing out of the hills past the walls of her father's house. Nen Lalaith it was named, and after it all the people of the household called the child Lalaith, and their hearts were glad while she was among them. But Túrin was loved less than she. He was dark-haired as his mother, and promised to be like her in mood also. For he was not merry, and spoke little, though he learned to speak early, and ever seemed older than his years. Túrin was slow to forget injustice or mockery, but the fire of his father was also in him, and he could be sudden and fierce. Yet he was quick to pity, and the hurts or sadness of living things might move him to tears. And he was like his father in this also, for Morwen was stern with others as with herself. He loved his mother, for her speech to him was forthright and plain. But his father he saw little, for Húrin was often long away from home with the host of Fingon that guarded Hithlum's eastern borders. And when he returned, his quick speech, full of strange words and jests and half-meanings, bewildered Túrin and made him uneasy. At that time, all the warmth of his heart was for Lalaith, his sister, but he played with her seldom, and liked better to guard her unseen, and to watch her going upon grass or under tree, as she sang such songs as the children of the Edain made long ago, when the tongue of the elves was still fresh upon their lips. "Fair as an elf child is Lalaith," said Húrin to Morwen, "but briefer, alas, and so fairer may be, or dearer." And Túrin, hearing these words, pondered them, but could not understand them, for he had seen no elf children. None of the Eldar at that time dwelt in his father's lands, and once only had he seen them when King Fingon and many of his lords had ridden through Dor Lomin and passed over the bridge of Nen Lalaith, glittering in silver and white. But before the year was out, the truth of his father's words was shown, for the evil breath came to Dor Lomin, and Túrin took sick.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.